Dippy went on national tour to different venues, and in between venues, it would have to be stored in crates and off-site. And we took the advantage of that to actually use that time to make detailed 3D laser scans of every single bone in Dippy. So that involved one person working full-time for several months, taking our laser scanning equipment and looking at each of those bones in turn to make really hyper-accurate virtual models of every single bone. And those models are accurate down to sub-millimeter level. They're almost as good as looking at the real thing. An adult Diplodocus skeleton has about 292 individual bones. Luckily, we didn't have to scan all of them because quite a few of those are combined into the skull, which sort of counts as one for our purposes. But there are lots of different bones to check, and each one of them had to be absolutely perfect in 3D so that they could be used as the basis for making physical molds to create the bronze casts. So our colleagues at Factomate were able to take all those scans, reassemble them into a virtual model of the whole skeleton, and use that virtual model to repose it in different ways, to check the scientific accuracy, and also to look at, if you like, just the dynamism of the pose and see if it could be done in a slightly different way to the original Dippy cast. They were also able to use those models as the basis for all of the engineering work that needs to be done on the skeleton, because there were lots of calculations that had to be made about the strength of the bronze, how large the skeleton was going to be, the safety factors that were involved whenever you put up a large public sculpture. And they form the basis for the engineers to be able to experiment with Dippy in a way that you simply wouldn't be able to do with the old plaster casts. A number of the challenges involve the fact that bronze is heavy and it's made of metal. It's much denser than bone and heavier than bone. So we're having to think of challenges that Diplodocus wouldn't have faced in real life because bones are simply made of different materials. So we had to think about the strengths between the joints, for example. When you have 15 neck vertebrae all arranged as a beam, they all have to somehow be supported by itself. There are 80 tail vertebrae forming that very long curved tail. And again, it has to be self-supporting and strong enough potentially to withstand things like high winds and also potentially vandals or accidental public incursions onto it where they might try and damage it or climb on it. So we had to think about all sorts of reasons to safety proof this, and this involved looking at the strength of those bronze casts and the kinds of stresses they'd be able to withhold through time, also as it aged, because this is something that we want to be in the gardens for many, many decades. We actually took a number of solutions for these problems from nature itself. So instead of going with solid bronze, for example, which would have been very heavy, although very strong, we decided to make the vertebrae partly hollow, which is actually what Diplodocus had in the first place. Diplodocus vertebrae are filled with air spaces and hollows to do with its very unusual lung system that it would have had when it's alive. So instead of having just solid shapes, we had ones that are partially hollow with little internal struts to help with that. And we also created a number of discs between the vertebrae, like the same ones that we have that occasionally cause problems when we get a bad back. But we actually created discs to go between them, which the living animal would have had too, to help dissipate some of those stresses and to allow the supporting structures to pass through each of those vertebrae without impacting the overall size or appearance of the overall skeleton. It was actually really exciting to go and visit the foundry where the bronze casts were being made, and also Factomate's facility where they were doing all of this amazing research work into how to turn those 3D scans into a real physical object. So you know, I've never been in a foundry before. I'm not sure I'll ever go in one again. But just watching them prepare these huge vats of molten bronze to be able to pour into the cast. And while we were there, they were actually making some of these casts for us. So we were able to see them pouring the bronzes into the molds to make them. And also while we were there, they revealed the skull. They just cast it and they brought it out in a huge block on a wheelbarrow. Casting material with the skull hidden inside. And then it looked quite rough, but what they had to do was tip this into a skip, and then two burly men with sledgehammers climbed into the skip and just hit this until suddenly this beautiful bronze skull popped out, and then they were able to clean it more carefully from that point. But you forget these things are made of metal. They're really strong and they're really tough, and it takes quite a lot of hard work to get to them. And in between that, we were also being shown the facilities of Factomate, who have such amazing 3D printers. They have amazing computer setups for modeling and also for creating really complex three-dimensional structures. And so that synergy between their expertise in creating those kinds of subjects and the expertise of the engineers in making sure it could actually stand up and withstand those stresses, plus the people working in the foundry who were able to actually make these objects, all came together beautifully with some of the science that we were doing as well. There were definitely some new engineering solutions come up with to make this work, because we decided that we didn't want lots of ugly props in the way of the skeleton. We didn't want props holding up the neck and the tail. So we had to find ways to make the neck and the tail self-supporting and to brace it against the various safety factors that we might have to face. So the engineers put a lot of time and a lot of effort into making it still look realistic, but at the same time making sure that it could support its own weight and that it was going to be a viable structure going forward. While we were this sculpture, we were finding a number of inconsistencies in the original Dippy cast that we could actually correct. So for example, one of the neck vertebrae in Dippy is upside down. And that's been an error that's been there since it was made in 1905. We decided to correct that. There are a couple of problems with the hands and the feet and the legs that we also corrected, and also with the hips. So the new sculpture is actually a more accurate version of Diplodocus than Dippy is. So we're able to bring in some of the very latest science and thinking about how those skeletons are put together into making that cast. And so once it was all done and all made, the bronzes all waiting in Spain, we had to then somehow get this huge thing from Madrid over to London. So it was crated up, everything was packed up and brought over to South Kensington. We had to do some quite extraordinary things to get it in the garden. We couldn't remove the railings, but it's obviously a very large object. So the museum got special permission to close the A4, the main road that goes west from London, for a couple of nights so that we could actually bring those lorries in and a crane to carry the sculpture over the railings and into its final place in the garden. One of the reasons that we decided to put a dinosaur in such a prominent place is simply to signal to the world the kinds of things we do. And also it was part of the garden redevelopment itself. So it's not only about the sculpture, but it's also about the things around it. So the whole garden is to tell the story of life through time, going right back to the formation of the earth through the development of the first life, the first animals and plants to make it onto land, and to show the whole diversity of the kinds of things we see on earth today. And the sculpture's there to signal one particular part of that diversity, the peak of dinosaurs during the Jurassic period, but all around it are a bunch of other things that show how we reached that point and actually got towards the modern day as well. So it's telling part of life's story as a whole, as a kind of nice, large item to focus attention on evolution and the story of deep time. So for me, this has been a really fun project. My first scientific paper was actually on Diplodocus and how it fed. So I've always been quite fond of Diplodocus as an animal, and I've worked on it quite a lot over the years. So being able to look out of my window every day and seeing this beautiful bronze sculpture of Diplodocus is just wonderful. And it also shows how the science that we do in the museum informs our public offer and how we combine the two things to have the most accurate information available, while at the same time having something really visually engaging to draw the public in and learn more about what we do.